Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for coming here for the Hackathon presentation, our first ever Festival of Learning event and the Hackathon. I would encourage you, if you are, like, at least so that you can see the presentation, but you can also stay there, wherever you are, get some food. One thing is, this event is being live recorded, and if you don't want to be in the camera, then sit actually, like, sit somewhere far away from the camera. The other thing is, we were giving out these forms, which is connected to the presentation feedback. So ignore the URL. We don't need to go to the URL to do this. But at the same time, the criteria that are given there, they are designed to guide the questions, giving feedback to the teams, and also the teams presented. Teams are going to present based on those criteria. So you can guide your discussion and feedback on those criteria. With that, I present the first team. You guys, all the teams, please introduce yourselves and talk about what you have done in this short 10, 12 hours. I don't know how long they slept, but okay. Okay.
Thank you. Hi, guys. So actually, before we get started, I'd like to send a massive thank you to the Festival of Learning and all our wonderful mentors. We could not have done this without you guys, so thank you so much. So, oh dear, we seem to have lost vision. That's never a great start.
Oh, that happens all the time.
Okay.
And we're back. All right. So, hi, I'm Katie. I'm here with my team, Beatrice and Shahad, and we're here to introduce a product that we're actually really excited about. So we met yesterday at like noon, and we were quickly united by a common struggle, organizing information when writing research papers. So I'm an undergrad in MIT Brain and Cognitive Sciences, which means I spend a lot of my time writing really dense papers with way too many citations, and it's kind of a hassle to keep track of anything.
I'm Shad Labib. I'm a graduate student here in mechanical engineering, and basically my laptop screen is always like my readings, my summaries, my like mind map, and I just like spend half of my time trying to get all my research and all the endless books and publication together to write. So we're trying to solve this problem for all of us.
So I'm Beatrice, and I did my PhD, so I have a lot of information to mingle and to understand and to hierarchize. So I have a lot of struggles to keep all the information in my mind. So I would love to have been able to have one application like this to help me visualize the relationships.
Right, so to deal with this problem, we're going to be introducing SnipMap. Basically what it does is it allows users to, with our Chrome extension, select snippets of articles or papers that they're reading online, tag them by content, create relationships to other information that they've already tagged and snipped, so we can view this information in a more visually pleasing way that makes sense and allows us to see the way information really connects. So, as we've said before, managing information is a really difficult task when you're writing a research paper. I often find that managing my information distracts me from the research itself. When I get really excited about a project, all I want to do is read stuff, start writing. I don't want to be worried about remembering where this was published, who the editor's second cousin is, so I would like something to keep track of that for me. So our program checks metadata from the papers that you pull from to make your bibliography for you. It also allows you to take notes and annotations. So say I'm dealing with a 100-page technical document and I want 3 sentences. I can make note of where it is, why I thought this was important, little notes to myself like, remember that word means what, not what you think it means, it's something else, different contexts. And it helps you re-identify relevant quotes from large documents. And another thing that's a big problem with poor organization that often comes with writing research papers is that you can lose really important relationships. I know that by about source 10, when I'm starting a literature review, I've completely forgotten where I started, and sometimes I miss really important connections. And a lot of science comes from realizing how information connects to each other, where the gaps are, where you should be going next. So we wanted to create a tool that can help with that. So I have kind of an example here of a literature review that I was writing this semester on linguistic relativity. For those of you who don't know, that's the idea that the language you speak and its associated structures changes the way you think, the way you perceive the world. So obviously this was a project I was super excited about because it's awesome. So on the left, you can see my kind of sketchy organization for how I was finding resources. It's on a Word document. Here's like the original philosophical argument against the thesis, some related things. It's kind of grainy, but you can see a lot of exclamation points because I was very excited about studies related to lateralization in the brain of relativistic effect, cool stuff. And then there's a thing down here for criticism. So there's some semblance of order and organization. I've tabbed things. But as you can see on the right, yes, that is the right side, I created a sample snip map of this information, and you can see that this is much cleaner, contains more information, and shows these valuable relationships in a much better and more understandable way. So let's take, for example, universal colors counterargument. So this is this argument that in like 85 different languages, there seems to be this hierarchy of languages that are named first. So this shows like, no, your perception of color doesn't depend on the words your language has for it. It's the other way around. So this is this main counter-argument to the theory of linguistic relativity. And as you can see, it has a lot of connections to the other evidence that I found. So we see this first primary red arrow pointing towards linguistic relativity as a thesis, which shows that it contradicts this original theory. Now, fear not, it has two red arrows pointing towards it. So we have lateralization effects, which contradict this. And we also have this highly philosophical thing that gets into types of luggage. It's a dense read, would not recommend, that fights against this argument. Now, we don't just have these red arrows. We also have these two green arrows. These indicate support. So we have these two developmental studies about children learning Setswana and Russian, both of which have very interesting conventions with color naming. So these support this argument. Now the last one that we see is this orange one over the top. Now this comes from a study about 50 years later and does a much broader cross-cultural kind of analysis of language words that clarifies and extends what's going on here. So we can see that from these colored arrows. So we're really excited about SnipMap, not just as a way to create these maps, but as a thinking tool. So first of all, we really hope that it will create opportunities for innovation in science and engineering. When you visualize data in this way that very clearly shows the relationships, you can see where the gaps are in existing research. Like, oh, there should be a red arrow pointing here. Why has no one done this study? It provides a great springboard for new study. It's also a thinking tool for writers as you're going through the writing process. This allows writers to develop stronger analytical and synthetic skills. So being forced to create a short SNP name for something that highlights what's really important about that SNP, generating tags to figure out what's most important about the content that you want to be able to find later, really forces you to condense information in a useful way and identify what's important. On the other hand, creating these relationships shows you how everything fits together and allows you to build complex ideas based on information interactions. So this encourages the cognitive processes of good writing, which we're really excited about. So now we have an app prototype that we're going to do a switcheroo into a different application for. So it starts out with a browser extension on Google Chrome, because hopefully everyone uses Chrome. So here we have a paper that we're reading, Problems of Literature. Seems interesting. So we have our little extension in the top right here, and we're going to click the button. And we've highlighted this section of the text because this is what we want our SNP to be. And our little SNP map menu pulls up. So I want to see, ooh, do I have to write a bibliography or did SNP map totally got me covered and has my information? This is awesome. So in my settings, I selected that I want APA format. So it's found that this is a dissertation. It's found the title. It's found the journal. It's found that it was from 2015. Awesome. Don't have to do anything. So now I've written some notes, written some tags, and I want to see what's going on with the relationships here. So I'm going to click relationships. This is kind of tiny, so I'm going to blow this up a bit. Cool, relationships. So you have two different things that you select to create a relationship. You select the relationship type, so you have clarified, contradicted, supports, extends. They can all be switched around so the arrow points the other way. You can create new relationships if you're like, oh, I actually want like causes relationships, if you're talking about causal relationships. And then you also search through your SNP objects to find which object it modifies or is modified by. And you create this relationship. So now, once you've found all your SNPs, you're really excited, you want to get writing, but you're like, oh, I wonder what this looks like when it's all organized. You would go to our desktop app. So our desktop app is organized like so. We have four boxes. The first one is our SNP collection. The second is our SNP map. We have individual SNP info here, so you can select stuff from above. And you have a place for you to actually start writing your paper, so you don't have to keep this minimized in another tab and have Word open in the right. These are also slidable, so if you're like, oh, I don't actually need to look at this right now, you can move things around and make it fit the way you want. So say I want to take a look at my linguistic relativity thing. So I'm going to click there. So I have SNP information, I have my exact SNP quote, I have relationships that I've created, it shows up in my map, it shows me where I've cited this in my paper, which is exciting. So I'm like, oh, well, this is kind of lonely up there. I want to see how it's related to things. So I first want to see contradicted and supports. So I see, oh, cool, direct relationships there, supported by this argument, contradicted by that, but that contradicts that. Already a mess, but I like messes, so let's add some more. Let's add clarified. Oop. So now we have this whole entire map that I showed you before that shows you these really cool, complex ideas in an easy to visualize format. So now I want to think about, I was really interested in that argument about the hierarchy of colors. So I have my tag of hierarchy, so I'm gonna click that. So now anything that's tagged with hierarchy is highlighted in yellow, so I can see exactly where it is, how they're related to each other, all that jazz. So, cool, now we're gonna switch through back. So this was like a 12-hour hackathon, so we have some additional features that we'd like to add. Once people actually start using this, we'd like to have a social feature where if you opt in, you can see how others have tagged and linked SNPs that you've taken from your sources, maybe from similar sources by the same author. That's something we'd love to see because it improves collaboration and research and will help you move faster. Also collaborative map making for multi-author papers. Maybe in my undergrad experience, I've been writing papers on my own, but I don't really know too many people who do that in the field. So it would be cool to have multiple users working on a map. It would also be cool to have touchscreen and mobile compatibility. I don't know who's doing research on a tablet, but like good for you if you are. I prefer my laptop, but many people do. So we'll get that ironed out. And then we'd also want to keep some accessibility options in mind. So if you're colorblind, those colored arrows are not going to be terribly useful, so we might add different textures, something like that. Zooming tools for people with visual impairments. Comparing click and drag options versus drop-down menus, what seems to be easier for people to use. Maybe there can be multiple options. Really, we want to optimize usability.
So looking what apps are out there and like there are so many apps that do a lot of different things. So the three main categories of apps are like snipping tools, mind mapping tools, and writing tools. So the snipping tools, I'm sure like a lot of people have used like Evernote or Mendeley to just like collect your sources from like online, like different online sources and put them all together. There are also a lot of mind mapping tools that like you put your ideas and it puts it on like kind of like a mind mapping format rather than a list format for you, like Gogear, Kogut, and many others. And there are also writing tools. So use writing tool when you get like bits of your writing a lot like in different pieces and you want to put them together. So what we want to do is instead of just me struggling of like, I use the snipping tool and then new software, mind mapping tool, new software, writing tool, and then like, okay, so where's my writing? I need to put this and that from here. So what we're trying to do is we put the functionality of all of these like snipping, mind mapping, and writing tools in like one app and one screen. That's like very important. I spend half of my day like just like minimizing and maximizing and trying to figure out what apps like I was doing. So having them all on one screen and like it, and like your writing and the sources and everything just like saves so much time. Each one of these saves some time, but if we put them all together, we could be way more efficient. So we also looked at shortcomings of similar apps. So Some of the people were complaining that some of these apps will just like invade their privacy. When you want to sign up for it, it says like, yeah, we could access your data, we could change it, and they don't like that. Some of them, they complain about when their battery dies, they lose some information, and some say that they want you to pay and they don't like to pay. And sometimes when they learn how to use the app after learning how to use it and all of that, they just tell you, okay, now time to pay. I was like, this is not fun. So these are some of the problems that we also wrote down to take in mind in case like we will develop this app. We would like to like get over these problems. And this one, it was a very interesting comment from one of the users of some of the previous apps, which like this guy exactly says, I want SnipMap. Sorry. So he's saying like, I like several taking notes, but I would like to have ability to mind map. We got it. Easier editing. We got the writing. Handwriting input is there. And more ways to sort out categories and subcategories, which we exactly said we're going to tag it. And it was so interesting. Right after building our, after like actually building it, just finding that someone exactly wrote the 4 points. Like, we need those 4 boxes. So it's so interesting to find that there are many people out there who would like to have that. So user testing, after making our software, we have tested a couple of people, and thank you, Bertha, for testing it for us. So her feedback was like, this app saves a lot of time, but allow me to focus on the content rather than the supporting information and the previous documents. So that's really interesting that you really love your topic. That's why you're writing about it. So I would like to spend more time like learning more than organizing. And this is also personally me. I spent the last 2 months just collecting my sources from the last 2 years. So I would like to go back to my content sometime soon. So our audience, so we want to make this app like for like a lot of different like kind of audience. Middle and high schools would like to do that because like since these children are still young and they're still in the learning process, like maybe I've learned to do like bullet points like since like I was in school, so I got used to it. But the people in middle and high school, if they learn it when they're like young, they could like grow up and be like way more efficient than we are nowadays because we did not have these technologies. So that's an interesting thing to look into. And also colleges, like students write endless paper, even like staff and faculty, like we write a lot of papers and would like to save time with like having relationships and subcategories automatically there. And industry, and that's where all the money is, so we need to look at that audience. So industry, of course, a lot of writing and journalism. So journalists, when they collect all this information and they need to write something down, having just like SnipMap open when they go to collect their information would like be really productive for them to go back and like get all these like blogs and writings going out. Scientific and non-scientific research, also like the same idea as our struggles. Also like management consulting. I've personally worked in management consulting before, and the whole problem is that you go to a client, they tell you, oh, profits are declining, what should we do? Or should we like merge an acquisition with this big company? Like how should that work? So the whole like idea about like management like consulting is just like trying to build the relationships between the causes and like similar like industries, and how could I be like the best in industry? How could I overcome these problems? See, if you start like snip mapping and like drawing the bigger picture of mind map, that would be really helpful in reaching like conclusions and decisions. And these management consultants are like traveling around the world and like always super busy, like, you know, like collecting a lot of data. So be really helpful to them and many other industries. Everyone writes, everyone needs to document. So it would be really productive for so many industries. So yeah, how will we implement that? So first thing is now, like we've taken 12 hours to review what are the current industries and what are similar apps and their problems, and we developed our app, but we still need to take a deeper look of the current apps and see like what are their advantages versus like disadvantages, to see if our app would be better to be added to a bigger like app that's already there, or to be its own thing. Because if you partner with someone, we could use their other like marketing and all their previous like knowledge, and we could learn from them. Or do we need to be our own thing? After that, we would need to go to web development because we're both, well, the three of us are not web developers, so of course we need like some software help on that. And then do more like broad user testings for audience to tell us what do they like, as she was talking about dragging versus like snipping, and then develop a modification and test to know like people's review to launch a pilot program. And our final slide is talking about the wider impact. That's just like an estimate that we're coming up, that we found in like a Forbes article on like big data analytics, that like 60% of the time is wasted on cleaning and organizing data. So our estimate, if this time just like goes down, you could like, everyone could be like double their efficiency. Of course, these numbers need like more studies and in-depth calculations, but if you get to double like every person's efficiency, you could do like twice as much as work. So if like students in colleges and high school and in industry could like do twice as much as work, that's a huge leap for the nation and development to like do so much work that we are able to do with this new technology. And thank you so much.
Thank you. So I would ask audience members to ask short questions related to all these pointers that are here. Let's say we take some questions for 3-4 minutes. The rest of the presentations are not as long as this one, so we are still planning to wrap by one. No, we allowed like a long presentation because you know we have enough time. So, question? Yes.
So one tool that I didn't see in your list is Papers, which I use to library and catalog all of my documents or my papers. So it has a lot of the functionality of your tool, doesn't do mapping. But one thing I really like is that because I have all of my papers organized in this library, I can easily send and share PDFs. It downloads, automatically downloads a PDF attached to a particular, you know, if you go to a web page and there's a PDF there, it will grab it and build a library with all your PDFs. So I'm wondering if you can consider doing integrating that functionality too. Not just link externally, but have the source, if it's available, within your library.
Yeah, so we have that in the back of our mind, and is the screen coming up? So here, this one should show like the SNP info, so it shows like the reference and like more information is gonna be shown about the actual book or where this comes from. So if you click on that, it will take you to the actual book. Mm-hmm. And then up there, it's also like it's gonna be organized in the bigger library by book. But also, this screen is more into this specific paper that you're writing. So these are the books that you use for big papers, but also like there will be like the bigger library that has all the books, but this is just to have your specific books in this specific reading so as not to be lost by all books. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Right. So I was interested in the part where you mentioned that it also helps you think on top of writing. So you mentioned the map about linguistic creativity. So what did you learn through the SNP map that you didn't have learned otherwise? What do you feel that you gained in terms of using it for that particular concept?
So for that particular concept, I mean, one of the things it pointed out is how contentious the field is. This is, as an aside, that was actually just the studies on color perception itself. Doesn't even apply to all the other fields like delayed gratification behavior, gender, languages. I think what it helped me see, so like this is the map itself, is how actually a lot of the contradictions started early off in the debate, and then everything kind of branched off into trying to support one theory or the other without directly contradicting other data. So you see this kind of initial conflict followed by later support and clarification that helps me find not a strictly chronological order for my paper or organization, but it does help me see where the conflict is organized and how I can go based on that. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. Thanks.
Thanks a lot for going first. That took a lot of extra guts, I think. And I thought you did a great presentation. Have a question for you about your long-term interests. What do you want to do with this project long-term?
So long term, like, I think it's, we're not like really sure like how long term should be different from short term, but I like thinking of the short term, like, we would like to have like on the short term, we would like to like people to be like more productive and get used to like organizing their
things. I meant for you guys working on the project. Do you want to keep working on the project to develop and implement it?
Yeah, so I'm not really sure about your question. Do you mean like our plans after?
Yeah, so if you have more resources, would you be willing to develop into a product, or like, is that? Yeah.
So like on the implementation slide, I was talking about that we need to study like more literature and then start that as the web development, and then we would look into like either partnering with a bigger like existing software, or if we should have our own. Does that answer your question?
You're fine.
We will have the resources. We do.
Separate related point. Probably didn't come across it, but there was a product almost exactly like this developed by at MIT, co-developed at MIT and Tufts University in the mid-2000s, late-2000s. Lourdes might remember you, Visual Understanding Environment.
Do you have ideas why didn't that go like really popular, or why didn't people start using it? Because that's the main
problem. I think one of the challenges, and this probably holds for all the groups, is I don't know how much time you guys focused on minimum viable product and the notion of minimum viable product. You guys gave a great vision for how it all fits together, but you have to start somewhere. You probably can't start everywhere. And so what pieces do you focus on when? And as time progresses, individual pieces get pulled off. So you had mind mapping, note-taking, and the third category, or the editing, the authoring, right? So they're best of products in each of those fields, right? And people gravitate towards them for whatever reason, but trying to be the best in all of the fields tends to be kind of a challenge. And so as time progressed, bookmarking services became a whole lot more useful and easier for people to use, and so that's why the view might not have continued as a product. As time progressed, people's ideas around creating repositories of their own information changed, and so those features might not have been used.
So yeah, that's another very interesting start that we could go with, is that if we could like talk to like different industries and see if they could like, if we could be the bridge between them, connecting them and putting it in one app. Because yeah, the bookmarking, like Evernote and many others are very useful, but my like manual translation from this point to that point is also like very time consuming. So if we could get to talk to different industries and bridge them together, that would actually make us gain more trust of the big name and everything. So and we would market it more. As you said, there's so many apps out there, but how many users, like how quick does that die? So just getting it out there and making people use it is one of the key things. You want
to
ask something?
I guess I'll have to stop the discussion here so that we can move on. And I encourage you to talk afterwards and continue this conversation. Okay, actually, we would encourage the second team to come on. Thank you so much. Please go take your seat and you can run. Oh, it's fine. Go ahead, make sure the audio works. Also, introduce yourself and then,
okay.
Yes, that's just for the video, so.
I see, okay.
Yeah, also, actually, it might be better if you are both on that side because,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, hi everyone, my name is Evan. I am an undergraduate student here at MIT.
I'm Nikolai. I'm not from MIT.
And so I met Nikolai and Harsh, who you guys will meet in a second, also yesterday at noon. And we all came together around this idea of, I guess, taking flashcards and trying to, or the idea of flashcards and trying to integrate them more into our lives. And so we wanted to, you know, think of as many ideas as we could, and really this was the hardest part of the last 24 hours, was just like going through all of these different ideas that we had and trying to figure out which ones we should focus on. So I have a few of the ideas that we had were, you know, maybe we should let users just, whenever they're on any page, click on something and create a flashcard. Maybe we should let them select certain text and make a flashcard. Maybe we should just take words out and have them try to fill in the blanks. Maybe we should, you know, focus on trying to make flashcards or like information, like phrase tags from videos or other text. And so we spent quite a long time going through all these different ideas. Like maybe we should focus on the temporal aspect, like how often should these flashcards appear in people's lives? And so we settled on our project, which we call Retainer. And so I will let Harsh take it away. Uh-oh. Is this the right video?
Yeah.
Okay. Is this the
audio turned on in the back?
Yes, they worked last time.
Or it's not the right video. It was the wrong video.
That we need for
So I will speed it up.
I think normal speed is normal. Normal speed is better.
Normal?
Yes, please.
We need for the Festival of Learning at MIT. Retainer is a software that runs on your browser. It's made by Evan, myself, and Nikolai. And it tries to solve the problem of people skipping retrieving information. So this is when you look at information and don't try recalling it, and so it doesn't get saved in long-term memory. And also, people stop reviewing flashcards. The solution to this is to auto-create test material. Test users while browsing. So we surveyed the existing plugins and extensions on the Chrome Web Store and found that there were many plugins that did what we were looking for. Many of them were unrelated or broken. So we decided to create our own proof of concept, starting with Wikipedia. We also used simple distractor algorithms to...
It's a background audio when he recorded. Yeah, he recorded here.
Yeah, okay.
Provide multiple choice questions. Our source is available on GitHub. If you go to this website, you can find not only the source code, but also how to install the extension. You first install TemporalMonkey, and then click on the Retainer user JS file, and TemporalMonkey will immediately ask you if you want to install the script while sharing the source code. It looks like this. After you agree to install Retainer, you will be delighted to find that there is a new button in the experience that when you go to Wikipedia. As you browse, you'll see a lot of content, and you'll be asked questions on these content when you press this button. So as you can see, now I have to answer questions about Alan Turing, and let's see what I do. So if I get a question wrong, you'll notice that the input field is colored red. If I get the question right, it's colored green. And I can go through and finish this. This quiz and try to see how well I read the article. This works on all Wikipedia pages. So if I go here, you'll notice that it works here, it works everywhere. Like that. So in the future, we plan on creating a browser-based part-of-speech tagger that allow us to figure out the nouns in block of text and provide better content for the tests. We'll also be able to get better distractors and learn, have some interface for learning from the mistakes you made while doing the test. Thank you for watching our demo. Welcome to retainers.
Yeah. So we can make a demo, for example, how you know history of a mate.
Would anyone like to take a shot at this?
Yeah.
Pick some.
Yeah. So
you can ask people questions.
Yeah. 1859 proposal was submitted to the nuclear reactors. Yeah. To use nuclear field lens in. Yeah. For. Conservatory of Art and Science. Yeah. Charter. For the. Yeah, but the proposal failed. Charter for the.
Yeah. Do.
Yeah.
So.
So. Incorporation of the Massachusetts Institute of Technology proposed by signed by the edX. Or one of the crochet. Probably this one. Yeah.
Yeah. So as you guys can tell, we don't have the best, so distractors is a word that Harsh used, so the other options in the multiple choice. Either, you know, some of them are like not the right parts of speech, maybe we take out an adjective when it's supposed to be a noun, or we have things like edX show up here and it just makes no sense. And so yeah, that's one thing we would like to work on, so maybe using something, some NLP type thing in addition to part of speech to improve what words we put there.
Do you want to try this one?
Yeah, so additionally, what I was working on this morning, which unfortunately I didn't completely finish, is trying to get this to work on other pages. So Wikipedia we chose because it's really nicely formatted. It's really easy. We just grabbed all the blue links. But on other pages, it's much harder to figure out where the text is and which of the text is important enough to take out. So I was trying to implement the system based on TF-IDF, which stands for Term Frequency Inverted Document Frequency, which kind of just finds which words are the most important and then sub them out for the same drop-down menus you saw on Wikipedia. So I got as far as figuring out which words the TF-IDF thought was important. Unfortunately, these words were not always super important. So like, here's an example of my code running on an NPR article. And over there, you can see for paragraph 7, these are all the words longer than two letters long and their scores. So the word with the highest score would be the ideal one to take out. But I think, let's see, can anyone spot what the highest thing is here?
Does.
Yeah, so taking out does wouldn't be super great. And so at that point, I kind of like, well, I don't know if I want to keep going and implementing the rest of this. But yeah, so ideally, we would further that even more into a more developed or sophisticated NLP system that could actually figure out which keywords or terms were most important to take out. Another future development we would like to implement is a backend. Right now, we're just injecting JavaScript into each of these pages. Mostly because it was the easiest thing to do, but in the future we would like to have a backend so that maybe users could even select which text they want to hide, so that in the future it would be hidden, and it could be also hidden on other pages as well. We could also with all of this data look at across all these different users what terms they like to hide, and so maybe those are the ones that we want to hide more often. And so as I kind of alluded to before, there are tons of different ideas and directions we can take this. And I guess what we really ideally want is just a system that works really well with your life and just integrates fully into your life and you know, kind of strengthens these little nuggets of information, which is what kind of flashcards are, so that you keep remembering them over time. And so I guess I should note, like for here, these are, we're taking out all the blue links, and ideally we wouldn't be taking out all the blue links, it would only be a fraction of them, and maybe, you know, concentrating on certain links and maybe distributing them over time so that, you know, memory is very temporal. And yeah, I guess, so the very last thing I want to mention before ending is that there are like many also different ways this could be used. And so one example is maybe you want to learn vocabulary, like you want to, you know, boost your understanding of words. You could just make a list of words you want to hide, and then it would work really well into this, right? It would just take out those words, and anytime it appeared on any page, you'd have to figure out which one it is. Another thing I thought of, as a student here at MIT, sometimes I type up, you know, study sheets or cheat sheets or just like kind of Bible documents for classes, and if this could be applied to that document, you know, it could just pick out key words from that document, and it would be really great to go through it almost like a Mad Libs and try to study for my test. Do you have anything else?
Yeah. Yeah, so does it work?
Please, just for okay. Camera.
Yeah, so because we had a very limited time, we tried to make minimum but viable product, so you or anybody else can use it, and then we can build on top of it more intelligence in generation of these options and better distractors and add some AI, including NLP and maybe backend. Yeah, yeah, we hope that you will find it useful. It's open source, and you can install it in your browser. And if you need to, if you're a student and you need to prepare for exam, for example, on sigmoid functions and one of the topics in this exam, you can go through Wikipedia pages related to the topics which will be on your exam. If you're not a student, you still can learn. It's lifelong learning. Thank you.
So in the interest of time, I think we'll take just one question and we'll move on to the next group, which if you can come up and start setting up, that would be great. Yes, go ahead, Connor.
Yeah, so just a quick comment and then a question. I think it'd be really great if you guys could take out just nouns. If you find a way to like just have like a way to identify nouns and remove just nouns, I think that'd be a cooler way to ask some of these questions. And then on another note, in the future, where do you guys plan on seeing this go? Like, do you want to make money off this? What do you want to do with this?
First about nouns. There is also idea about taking numbers and percentages and like years and history pages and so on. Yes, so there are many ideas. Where do we want to go? We want to build more intelligence into selecting choices.
Maybe you can add something. I mean, I think for me at least, the most value I get out of this is just that it's like useful for me and it can reinforce my learning.
Yeah. So I think we will keep it as a toy project for now, and if the users will comment, it will be useful for people. We can add more features and like do some customer development on these users. Yeah. So yeah, at this moment it's usable, so we will take a look whether people need it or not. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hopefully it's yeah.
Oh no. Is that?
You gotta hold it at an angle.
Yes, that's weird. You can
start talking about it.
Yeah, you can start talking about it. You should. Okay. Go ahead.
Okay. Okay, so my name is Jason, and this is my friend
Enrico.
So we were thinking, you know, when we're studying for a test or something, and we have a, we're going through all of our practice problems for a class, right? A lot of the practice problems, we get really, we don't need to practice very much. They're like easy, so we would rather not spend time on those questions, and we'd rather be able to flag problems that are giving us trouble, things that we know we need to review more, and like how to generate more practice on those types of problems.
Right, so at the moment, we just kind of, I mean, unfortunately it's not coming up on the screen right now, we had just kind of written a simple program in which you could save problems that you had trouble with word for word. You could copy them into a text file, and then this program would essentially call one up at random, and if it found any numerical values within the problem, it would randomize them while maintaining roughly the order of magnitude. I mean, at the moment in our current implementation.
One question, sorry to interrupt. Does anyone have a spare Mac dongle? The regular Mac dongle?
Okay, stay away from the table, don't touch.
Okay. All right. Okay.
Oh, thank you.
So in the meantime, I'll try to break it down. So essentially, it pulls up a problem at random. If it finds any numerical values within, it will randomize them. So you can kind of, you have a set of problems that you know you need more work with, and it'll kind of give you a slightly fresh version of the problem, as well as just kind of cycling at random through these problems. So it's not something that you just settle into a groove and kind of produce these automatic answers without really feeling that you understand them. At the moment, we just have two problems already loaded in, as you can see. Would anybody like to propose, I don't know, a third, just like simple math problem?
If you have two apples,
perfect.
Can I give you four more apples?
Okay. I don't know, I have two apples, you give me four. How many, for the sake of time? Okay. So now if we read here, we have these three problems. Now, the study function will pull up. This actually didn't randomize at all by...
You got lucky, yeah.
Right, so okay, for example, here we went, now the stone is falling, you know, 5.5 seconds as opposed to the 5 seconds that it was originally. Clearly, you know, this is a really minimal product, speaking of minimum viable. But so ideally what we would like to see this implemented as is kind of an add-on to an edX course, in which maybe you would have a side tab in which you could keep track of these problems that you were having trouble with. Now obviously, we would want to put a lot into the back end, as the other group was saying. Obviously, you don't want just a text file out there that could get, you know, corrupted. Maybe you accidentally play with it, and suddenly you can't call up the problems anymore. So we would like to have that stowed away. Another feature that we would like to eventually implement is to be able to have kind of multiple lists of problems and sort of be able to maybe organize by a more specific subject matter within this. Also, given that it just randomizes these kind of decimal values, at the moment it really only lends itself to, you know, physics and mathematics and just generally where problems are more just kind of number crunching, essentially.
And so the important thing here is that, like, it lets you add the problems as you go for more complex versions, and so that you don't have to review entire sections to get to those problems, like in the edX courses, so that you have this running file that, like, before your test or before your final, it picks the problems that you designate as the most important that you think you really need, so that it's personalized and not just so that you review every section. As far as expanding this to problems that don't just have numerical values, chemical equations would be easy to implement. You know, biologic, like genetics, these things would be easy with the format that we already have. Apply to 801X, for example. And it would be really easy add-ons.
I mean, yeah, just the one final thing I like to add on is that generally we feel that, you know, just kind of having a more personalized education, especially on these online platforms, is really, in our opinion, the direction that we should be trying to go in, because obviously not everybody learns the same, not everybody, you know, is able to handle the same problems in the same way, and just being able to really zone in on what you need to focus on, especially, you know, with impending deadlines or tests and whatever, can be really valuable.
Do you have anything else to add?
Okay, thank you very much.
One very quick question, and while you come up and set up your stuff. Yes, Mary Ellen.
So if you have a problem and it's random, where is your computer? How do you get to the answer expected for the new problem?
So
there's something
from
between population and human factors.
Right, so as far as using it as a personal study tool without implementing it to edX, that would have to be something that you keep track of. But I talked to Enrico about this, and like if we had this as an edX add-on or a side tab, then you could program in like that how you would calculate the answer when you designate these problems, and that would be easy to do once you had like a backend. As far as using it for a personal study tool, that would be.
I would like to add that currently in certain testing forms of edX, they do have kind of a way to answer check on, you know, values which shift, and we just feel that this kind of concept could be applied more so to just as a personal study tool. So if we were to try to merge this with edX, the systems would be in place essentially.
The most important new thing would be designating the problem specifically and adding it to a side tab for review.
What are you going to call it?
Good question. We haven't thought of a name. We're open to suggestions.
Good job.
Thank you. Okay. So I'm Alex, and for this hackathon, I coded up a site to basically tabulate a lot of information about various research on MOOCs, as well as suggest future hackathon future projects, and one can create hackathons and also provide an interface for people to find data about MOOCs or open MOOCs data sets where a lot of data, where a lot of the data right now is hard to find because it's not open. So this results in independent projects like ones I'll show later, which have potential to be really interesting because they're coded up really well, but suffer due to a lack of data. And I hope to ultimately reduce the friction it takes to analyze MOOC data by linking to these and pointing out to MOOC sources. And also perhaps to introduce some sci-fi futuristic thinking into the MOOC environment, because I think people who talk about MOOCs, they kind of lose sight of the big picture, which is really exciting. But right now, there's sort of a valley where a lot of people are still criticizing MOOCs because there are still some implementation things that need to be figured out. So anyways, I have super high effects from MOOCs. I'm really curious, but I don't exactly do farewell under traditional courses, so this only massively increases my motivation and affect for MOOCs as an alternative way of learning and disciplining myself to learn. And I'm also really fascinated with I'm also fascinated with collecting information all over the internet. So I found a couple of visualizations which I found really useful, and one of them was open, which I really hope will reduce the friction it takes for other independent people to do mini projects on MOOC data, which does exist, but somehow we're gonna have to ask people to volunteer it. So Yeah, another thing is with society, I also hope to inspire some discussion about some of the larger transmod MOOCs, for example, try to increase discussion about offering MOOCs to younger people so that younger people can use MOOCs as an alternative to school. Of course, there are MOOCs as learning tools for older people, and then MOOCs as certificates. And while there are a lot of MOOC sites already, like classcentral.org, they do tend to be a lot of noise, and they lose a sight of the bigger picture. So I tried to obtain a lot of data. I wasn't able to find the data that I was really quite looking for, so I ended up turning it into a site that. So one thing, of course, is we need to focus MOOCs on improving learning efficiency. And how do we do this? We use data. I would like to emphasize connections between MOOCs and sites like openhumans.org, where people can volunteer their data to be, where people can opt in and be guinea pigs, so that their data can be used to track their engagement over time, especially with use of quantified self-sensors. And, this education psychology research, I'm really interested in trying, and at least doing what I can to increase attention to this potential. And there is a really good quote I put on my site later. So cognitive science research, this is what I really want to see as well. I wasn't able to find the data, but there were some papers, like ones by Philip Goh, that highlighted the role of independent learning styles. And one thing that I'm really interested in is trying to organically create, discover through big data learning styles that that aren't affected by our prior conceptions of what learning style is. Like, people say there are visual and auditory learners, but I'm not sure if big data has actually been used to support this. Another thing I'm really interested in is learned helplessness, which also appears a lot in educational settings. And if we can track maybe a fall off in say completion rates after a certain hard problem is assigned, we might better able to figure this out. So, and of course, here's an idealized long-term future. It sounds kind of Black Mirror-ish, but I would at least like to highlight the possibility, just because it will bring up some interesting discussion that otherwise wouldn't be brought up, and help bring more precise thinking. And identify learner types. So one thing I did look up in my research was basically the documentation for the new edX platform, which is really good to read, and which can hopefully, if we can encourage people to export it, can help finally identify them. And here's some existing web apps that I found. This one is MOOC Mooches by Katie Jordan. She's amazing. She also compiled an entire literature review of MOOCs. And one hackathon idea might be to help modernize this interface. Oh, another thing is that another hackathon idea would be to, these are papers from a certain conference that happens every April at the MIT Media Lab, and connect them. These are some other ideas, and here's another idea I put up. John Montre, he created some really awesome visualizations based on this data. Using R, and although I wasn't able to run with my R installation because of a specific error that happened in the code, but I've already emailed him about it. And what I hope, and let's see. Okay, so what I hope to get out of this is that I hope to connect with the people I've mentioned and ask for their input. And if they have anything they want to bring into my site, I would like to bring more advertisement to these ideas and hopefully bring a more centralized discussion of the future of MOOCs and hopefully use it as a way of influencing people's thinking on MOOCs in the future. And as for the minimum viable product, it's a web page, and since I'm really passionate about MOOCs, it motivates me to update it with everything new I discover about MOOCs.
And quick questions. So is the website up already?
Yeah, it's up. Let's see here. It's mostly text at the moment because I originally put this as a slide and I was only able to put it aside after I wasn't able to obtain the data sets that I really, really tried hard to look at. So basically here's an outline of what it is so far. I'm definitely going to add more to it later. Evo One is amazing. I haven't seen many MOOC link aggregators link to the exact right set of things that I'd like to bring attention to in terms of charting the future of how we can collaborate more in MOOC research. Right now it just seems like a bunch of people who are just super independent of each other. And this is something that we might be able to discuss later at, for example, the April conference at MIT.
Okay, so if there is no other question, Connor.
Yeah, brief question for you. So do you want this to be something that you're doing personally to connect people, or do you want this to be more open so other people can contribute to your site?
I would love it to be more open.
Okay.
And I'm totally open to suggestions from anyone. Like if you have any random thought about moves you'd like to send some attention to, just email it to me.
Okay. If there is no other question, we can close the presentation part and we will talk briefly around at the back so that we can come up with the decisions about prizes and all these things, and we can make that announcement shortly. So hang around, have more food. There's a lot of food. Chat with your colleagues and we should be able to come up with the announcements very soon.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hello. So we have good news, and we have managed to sort through all these presentations. So for participation, we really thank you, Alex, if you could just come here.
Thank you. Great job.
For the impact category, we are looking at you, Jason and Enrique. You're welcome. For the implementation and viability, we have chosen the retainer project. Is there anyone? Oh, yes. Here, Evan and Nikolai, and we also have a certificate for Harsh. We would try to get in touch. He's not here, so actually we'll get to him. And finally, the audience choice award goes to SnipMap. So you guys can come over. And Shahad is not here, so I guess she's probably coming here very soon. And we are going to get in touch with all of you about prizes. And we would email you as soon as we have all our finances in order. So with that, thank you so much for participation and working through the night. And excellent job, everyone.